I'm always happy to meet students of art, because although I have been talking of human awareness, self-awareness, self, nature of self, I find that the best way we express ourselves outside of ourselves is through art. And therefore, when I meet artists, I feel here is a group of people with whom I can share common thoughts and common joys. So I'm really happy to be in this class today. Art in any form is an expression of the self. On that there is no doubt that art expresses the self. What raises issues is what is the self. The self is more difficult to identify than art. Because if we could identify the self, we would really be able to see what art is. Because art is merely an expression of that self. And is human self only one self, something within which we express? Or is it a layer of selves? Does it consist of more than one angle or aspect which comes out in different art forms or at different times in the same art form? What is the self that comes out? It's a very interesting study. Because if we can really find out what gets expressed in art form, we have got a good key to discover the raison d'etre for art. As it were, to understand what art signifies for human beings. The significance of art will arise from its relationship to the human self. Well, we regard ourselves physically sitting here as ourselves. That's the first thing we realize. And whatever is associated with our physical self appears to be part of ourself. That is why if we draw beautiful landscapes which our eyes see, they are ourselves, because that's what the eye sees. If we can draw other paintings of the human body, of the human being, and that's what we are looking at through our eyes, through the same self, and that's us. If we have other forms of art, including music, performing arts, theater, drama, dance, again we find that we are representing what is part of our physical self. We are expressing that. The simplest self which gets expressed in art is the physical self, which arises out of our physical body and its ability to have sense perception and the world around us which we experience through those sense perceptions. This is the material from which we find expression. That's a very simple form of art, the simplest. And a sophisticated artist normally does not stop here. In fact, hardly any artist of any significance will use this material for expressing himself. Though we may use this material for teaching classes in art. The most significant part of the human self is sense perceptions per se without the physical body. The ability to sense without associating it with the physical form. When I say, I am seeing this paper, am I really seeing this paper with this physical eyes? If I were, I would only see the paper when I have my eyes open. Even when I have my eyes closed, I still see the paper. The power to see does not seem to belong to the physical eyes, though it does seem to belong to the sense perception of sight. When you hear my words, you hear them with these ears. But do you hear everything with these ears? For instance, you hear your own thought, your thoughts spoken out by your mind in words. You hear them. Do you hear them with these ears? Do the physical ears have any relationship with the experience of listening? What is not physical? Yet the listening is the same. The capacity to listen is not dependent upon these ears. It exists so long as we are conscious.
So it is a capacity of consciousness. The same thing is true about other sense perceptions. We have an ability to perceive through senses without the use of any of the physical organs of sense. When we perceive through senses without the use of the physical body, we are moving on to a deeper layer of our own self. And art really begins from there. Art begins by expressing ourselves from that experience of the self which does not use the physical body, yet uses sense perception. People have tried to use many words for this experience. Imagination, memory, hallucination, all kinds of things. All kinds of words have been used for people who can perceive without the use of the physical sense. But the fact is, that is the self that really comes out in art. What name shall I give to that self? If you bear with me, I am going to use some Oriental names and their translations into English, so that you just have a list of classifications. Don't take them too seriously and don't have a hand up on a word. Just go along with the meaning of that word. If you want to use any other word or suggest to me some other word for that, I'll use that. Words are no importance. I'm trying to communicate directly to your ability to perceive. People talk in this country of astral projection. They say, we left our physical body here and we walked somewhere else attached to the silver cord and came back. And when we were there, we saw what was happening there. We heard, we touched, we smelled, we tasted. We did all that the sense perception could do here. But the body was here. Maybe I can take up that term just to describe that part of the human self which uses sense perceptions without physical sense organs. Would it be all right if I call that self our own astral body? Okay, let's say that the astral body of a human being is the one that gets reflected in art. I would say that the astral life of a human being, the life that is associated with self-perceptions not functioning through physical body, is the source of all art and most of creative work upon this earth. It does not arise from what we see here at all. Very little of it. Because what this physical body can see is a very small part of what the astral body can see. Astral seeing, vision, is not limited by what is placed before it. This vision is. These eyes will only see what is placed before these eyes. The imaginative eyes of the astral self have no such limitation. They can see anything they want to see. Therefore, we see, we hear, we touch, we taste, we smell far more all the time with our astral self than with the physical body. In fact, the physical experience we have is a very small, limited part of our total conscious experience as to me. We don't realize it because of an illusion that this is being a physical body. That is imagination, something airy. It's a big illusion. The illusion is that we don't regard that thing as ourself. The fact of the matter is, this physical body gets the capacity to perceive because of that. If we did not have the power of seeing astrally, we would have no power to see with the eyes. If we were not conscious, we would not be able to see with these eyes, even if these eyes are open. It's not the opening of these eyes that makes us see. It's these eyes being given the power to see with the astral eyes that see even physical things. All perception is therefore arising from that level of sense perception within ourselves. It's not somewhere outside. It's not up in some high mystical region. No. It's right here where we are sitting. Right in our consciousness. Is it really necessary for perception to be broken up into senses? I would like to pose this question to you, that when we talk of perception, we seem to immediately jump to the conclusion that perception must be through senses. Is that really necessary? I am not talking of physical senses or astral senses, any sense. Is it really necessary for me to hear the sound of this paper, to touch it, to taste it, to smell it, to know that it's a fruit? Or can I know it without this into separate sense perceptions? Does human awareness have the capacity to perceive anything without breaking it up into sense perceptions? Surely it has. If it did not have the capacity to perceive directly without senses, and if all perception was linked to senses, we could never perceive what is meant by jealousy. I use the word jealousy. You neither see it, nor touch it, nor listen to it, nor smell it. Nothing happens. But you know, you perceive it mentally. The human mind mentally can perceive without having to break up perception into senses. If you study this little closely, if you study our own system of operation of awareness, you will find that mental perception is in fact the root cause of perception, that you do not perceive with the senses at all. That if you merely saw with the eyes, whether these eyes or the so-called astral eyes or the eyes of imagination, if you could merely see with the eyes of imagination, you would merely have an image before you. It means nothing. Seeing does not mean having an image before you. Seeing means knowing what the image is. Seeing means interpreting the image. That is why they say, well, the brain performs an interpretive function. And then only you see. How does the brain interpret? In an evolved animal, like human beings, it interprets through the rational mind. And that's a beautiful thing. The rational mind uses reason. And reason is used in thoughts. And thoughts are in words. And words are phonetic symbols, having association of ideas to give connotation to them. And when we see a paper, what is really happening is that the power to see picks up the image of the paper or any other sense perceptions connected to the paper. If this image is placed before the mind, and the reasoning, sensing mind picks up this impression and says to itself, that's a paper, and we hear it, and it becomes a paper. All senses can be reduced to the sense of listening. Looks very strange, but the fact is that all our perception is eventually listening. We listen to the mind telling us what it is seeing. We listen to the mind telling us what it is tasting. We listen to the mind telling us what it is touching. This is because we are evolved. Therefore, we have a sophisticated perception. Perception is possible by the mind without using these either. Because perception is the quality of the mind, not of the senses. The senses only presented images, impulses, elements of perception. The elements, images, segments represented, the mind perceived. If we had no mind, the senses could do nothing. Even if they went on seeing and touching and tasting and hearing and smelling. Even if the senses continued to function, we would not perceive. Therefore, mental perception with which we are familiar is in fact a deeper part of our own self-perception. In fact, that perception is the cause of our knowing what we are perceiving. Without that, we would not know what we are perceiving. If we don't mentally perceive what the senses have placed before us, we would not even know we are seeing. The cause of all our experience based on sensory perception is the mind. Mental perception is the cause. The sensory experience is the effect, not the other way around. If the mind did not have the capacity to directly and mentally perceive, to interpret, to give meaning to things, there would be no experience at all. That is why the mind is often referred to as the causal form of a human being. And often referred to as the causal body. If you don't mind, I'll still use the word causal body in relation to the astral body that I spoke of earlier. Then what I'm really saying is, we have a physical body with very limited capacity to use power of perception. That the sensory perceptions per se are the astral body having unlimited capacity to perceive through senses, but not having the capacity to interpret perception as we know it. The mind, the causal body, is the cause of all experience. And a true artist now really comes out from the real cause, from the mind. He doesn't even produce what is in the senses. Here is an artist, deep artist. So he is producing, he doesn't even know where it's coming from. It's so deep, he has never gone in to see where it's coming from. In fact, he cannot see where it's coming from, therefore he's putting it out. An artist expresses himself out because he cannot express himself in. Of course, some people have the capacity to reverse this direction of flow of attention and art and creativity into themselves. And they are called self-realized human beings. They know what the self is. But the artist is flowing his direction of attention outside. Therefore, he expresses his inner self outside and expresses that level, that depth of his inner self outside, of which he is keen to know. This is a desire for self-realization. An artist fulfills his desire for self-realization by placing outside of himself what really belongs to inside. He is really trying to find out what is in. But since he can't go in, he goes out. And when he goes out, he takes himself out. And that is art form. Mental perception placed outside in art form is a real inner form of the human being placed outside. Is this mental perception merely gathering of ideas and interpretation, or does the mind do anything more than that? It's not so simple. The mind is a complex part of ourself, more complex than sense perceptions. Let me tell you the functions of the human mind. Then you will understand how they get reflected in our form. The lower part of the mind does what I have described now, which is sensing. It senses what the sense perception does receive. It interprets. It gives meaning to it. It makes them experience. It makes it elements of experience. This lower mind, the sensing mind, is picking up all this information and giving us experience. Then there is the middle mind, the most important part of human mind. That's called the thinking mind. That's the one that thinks in words. And that's the one that thinks continuously without break. Day and night, whether we are asleep or awake, the thinking mind is in action. It uses reason, logic, intellect, possesses ego, assertiveness. All those qualities we ascribe to a human conscious being are being used by the middle mind through its thinking power. Then there is the top part of the mind called the creative mind. The creative mind does not really create anything. It uses the same segments and elements of perception that have been put up before it through the sensing mind. But through the churning process of thinking and intellect and logic, plus the permutation and combinations in new patterns and designs, it produces something new. What it creates is a new form, a new pattern, a new design. Not the substance of that form or design. The creative mind is responsible for the highest works of art, literature, performing arts, and so on. It is from there that all this has come. Whatever has been brought into being in a form which has a beginning, a middle, and an end arises from there. Now I'll come to this beginning, middle, and end in a while again. I want to draw your attention to the fact that all the apparatus of human awareness, which I have discussed so far, the physical body, the sense perceptions, the sensing mind, the thinking mind, the creative mind, all these function in the framework of space, time, and causation. None of these experiences can take place if there is no time, if there is no space, and if it does not follow the laws of cause and effect. I am drawing your attention specially to this because I will now speak of that part of human awareness which does not function in this frame. sensing, reasoning, creating are all part of the time-space causation framework. But we have something beyond that, beyond the mind, beyond these frameworks, within human awareness. Something else that is also functioning, performing three functions. Beyond these three functions of the mind, human awareness performs three more functions. One, intuition. That intuitive flash of information coming from nowhere, taking no time to come, following no laws of cause and effect. The intuitive flash was not there and then it is there. You do not know where it came from. It takes no time at all, not even a fraction of a second. But when you think about how it came, that takes time. You brought the mind again. The timeless intuitive flash is contemplated by the time-consuming mental thinking in order to consider what happened. With our present system of education, in which we are sharpening the instrument of intellect only and not bothered about intuition, we have reached a point where the intellect, by its reasoning power, thoroughly developed through the educational process, normally not only rejects but destroys the intuitive knowledge. The intuitive flash which comes, which is the real self, more real of the human self than the mind, it is destroyed by our thinking. Oh, that can't be. It doesn't fit in with our logic. The second function being performed from the higher level of awareness is love. The mind had no such function. Love is a function of the spirit beyond the mind, the human individuality beyond the mind. Love is the experience of identifying oneself completely with another. When this happens, and it happens to us, to human beings, it happens in a flash, same flash as the intuition. It was not there, and it is there, and there is no time lag between the two. You don't know where it has come from. There is no cause and effect relationship at all in the experience of love. But this love is not the one you speak of generally here. We have all had experience of love. There is no human being in whom love doesn't flash out, as there is no human being in whom intuition doesn't come. We all have these flashes, but we wipe them out. We destroy them with a highly developed intellect and reasoning power. But I am mentioning this, that this is not the same love about which you keep on hearing on the campus here, I love you, I love you. Because that is not love what they talk about. This identification with another person means you forget yourself. In the kind of love I speak of, you don't remember yourself then. Because you are in the other person's place. You begin to think, feel like the other person whom you love. If somebody says, I love you, you can be sure that guy loves I more than you. It's more of an ego trip than love. Therefore, if there was real element of love, and not attachment, which I love you represents. Attachment has a feeling of two, I and you. That's attachment, that's a mental activity. The activity of the human spirit, spiritual, soul, individual, self, real self, that activity of love completely identifies you with the other person. And if you had to speak out something, you wouldn't even be able to remember love or I. You would say, you, you, you. That's all you can say. That's a function beyond the mind. The third function beyond the mind is beauty, aesthetics. The aesthetic experience of human awareness arises from there, not from the mind. The mind with all its craft and effort cannot create beauty. It can destroy. If you have a beautiful painting, you see the beautiful painting and its beauty because of that capacity of the human spirit to see beauty. After you have seen it, if you start examining where it is coming from, you destroy it. If I have a beautiful painting up here, and I bring it on this table, and I cut it into strips with the scissors, with a pair of scissors I make small strips, and then I cut into 1-inch squares, and I place a heap of that painting from this table, and ask each one of you to see that painting 100 times over, each piece 100 times over. You will never see the beauty of the painting. All you have done is to break that painting, analyze it. Analysis. You use the mind. Mental function is analysis. Intellectual function is analysis. And the spiritual function, the soul function, the real higher awareness function is synthesis. putting it together. Intuition, love and beauty are arising from that part of human awareness which synthesizes, puts together, sees the whole. The mind cuts it to pieces and analyzes, breaks it up. Now when you find that this highest